Jennifer Sedlock is an inspiring and educating speaker who moves audiences to action. She gets to the heart of the issues and is laser-focused on helping people get to the results they want in life. Coming from years of management and training, she will walk you through the steps and strategies to conquer your roadblocks and get on with your talents, plans, and purpose. Jennifer is helping thousands of people to make choices and changes that will impact the rest of their lives. Please welcome Jennifer Sedlock.
Hi, welcome to Communicating Beyond Your Own Style. Have you ever met someone and everything just clicks? Have you ever had the opposite happen? Have you ever sat across from someone and wondered, what are they thinking? Where did they even come up with that? Have you ever wished you could just get inside someone's mind and figure out why they think the way they do? We all have strengths, abilities, interests, and unique personalities. What might be surprising is that there are equal and opposite gifts to ours. These differences can cause a lot of tension and misunderstandings. However, this can be actually a great source of balance of strengths when making decisions together. This program is going to cover the four areas of preference on how we get our energy, how we receive information, how we make decisions, and how we like to operate in the world. You can figure out your type and others and learn ways to improve communication with all types. You know, sometimes things just click with others and sometimes they don't. The danger we run into is if we think that everybody should think like us, do things like us, and process the way we do, because they really don't. And people aren't out to irritate you. They really are just being themselves and doing things the way that works best for them. So sometimes what works great for one person is actually a problem or hindrance to another. So it's really important that we don't force who we are on people, that we seek more to understand why they are the way they are, and then work together. Because actually, those people that you communicate really well with and it's really easy, you have the same blind spots. So better decisions are made as a couple, as a team, as a group of people, even with your kids. Better decisions are actually made when you have a little bit of that friction, because what's behind it is you have opposite gifts. You think and process things differently, you make decisions differently, and that's not a bad thing. So I hope I take you today from frustration to appreciation of those differences. This program is called Communicating Beyond Your Own Style because we all do have our preferred way of doing things. There's two ways we get our energy, either from people or from being alone. There's two ways we can receive information. One is more from the big picture, future thinking, or more the opposite of detailed, here and now thinking, and very sequential. There's two ways we can make decisions, more on the logical, rational, focused on the task and the law. Or you might make decisions from the opposite more often, and that is from the compassionate, situational, focused on the people it's going to impact. We live our lives in order and planned out, or maybe the opposite, flexible, spontaneous, and adaptable. We do choose all of these at various times, of course, but we tend to fall into patterns of comfort on what we prefer, and then over time, we've perfected those preferences until we're very good at them, and we can have a little blind spot to the other at times. So sometimes we think our way is better, but we don't realize that the opposite way can actually be just as effective for others. And again, that really balances out when we're trying to do some things together. So we're simply better together, even though the process may take a little time and focus. In this CD, you're going to learn those different styles, figure out where you fit, learn some key ways to improve communication and success with some of the other people in your lives, at work, at home, in your family. The basis of this is Myers-Briggs Type Indicator. And whether you know nothing about this topic or a lot, you're going to gain some insight into your style and others, what you do to communicate with others, and how to actually go beyond your style. Not changing who you are, but go beyond your style to communicate to others more in their style, because you will be able to connect better that way. There is an entire page dedicated to Myers-Briggs on my website, so you can look for that if you want to find other sources and links to publishers, all kinds of information on there. So let's get started. The first thing we're going to talk about is preferences, because we have to define that as I'm using that word. Imagine writing your signature as you normally do it. What does it feel like? Sort of like autopilot, right? You do it all the time. It's not a big deal. You don't even think about it. You just do it. Now imagine breaking that arm and having to sign with your opposite hand. It's awkward. Might take some more thought. You'll probably do it slower, messier, and you might even feel like a child again. This is the nature of preferences. We prefer something over another. It's not that we can't do the opposite or that we choose too many times. It's that when it gets down to it, we just prefer some things over others, and we have for a while. So we're going to talk through four areas of preference, and when we do, I'm going to explain it, give examples, give ideas of how to figure others out, and then how to use that information. So we're really going to be answering two questions throughout. What is it? Meaning, how do we figure it out in ourselves and others? Two, how to use it. How do I communicate different with others who are my opposites? Because you already communicate very easily with those who are the same. And again, there's four different areas of preference, so you could be the same on a couple areas with someone, or three areas, or four areas, or none. So if you're all four letters different with someone, you probably have a strain in the relationship. So as you think, as I'm talking, go ahead and think about all the different people in your life, especially maybe even people in the past. Our families influence us, especially our father and our mother, old bosses, current bosses. Those all can have a huge impact on having to mold to their style to get the results we want of just moving forward in some of the things we need to do. And having been, anytime we have authority, if we look at their style, the more we're like them, the easier that relationship is. And again, with every relationships. Okay, so let's start with that first area of preference. And this area is about, where do you get your energy? There are extroverts and introverts. And those are just labels, and try to forget what you think already about them. That's just some words that they came up with that best describe it. But extroverts tend to gain energy from people. They have a breadth of relationships, and they really like to expend energy. They're open, disclosing. They like short, interrupted time frames. They're pretty sociable, outgoing, and expressive. Pretty much what you see is what you get with an extrovert. They are typically very external with the way they communicate. And they really are, like I said, interested in external events. They like to approach people, and they do like to talk because they get energy from it. And many times they'll speak and then think about it, about whatever the content is. So let's flip that around to the introvert. Their interest is more in the inner world versus that outer world. In the inner world of ideas and reflections, introverts tend to be a little more reserved, territorial, contemplative. They like to concentrate, so they like long and uninterrupted time frames to think through things, especially if they're trying to make a decision or coming up with an answer to your question. They want more time. They want to process it internally before they process it with you out loud. They maintain fewer but deeper relationships. They like to conserve energy, and they're interested in internal reactions. So they're private, guarded, and they tend to think a lot before they speak. So with introverts, one of the strengths is that inner world, and that when they say something, it typically is well thought out, and there's a lot more to it than they even tell you. With an extrovert, their strength is they will respond right away, and they are very expressive, but they also might come back 24 hours and change their mind as well. So for every strength that we have in whichever style we prefer, there are also blind spots, because the extrovert sometimes can say things, like I just said, and then change their mind. they really need to work it out verbally. And so they'll say a lot of things before they make a decision. And sometimes people can be led to believe that they are going to do all those things, or that they need to consider all those things. Whereas an introvert only brings out maybe the end result. So the introvert, one of their blind spots might be that they don't react right away, and that they don't appear to be even listening sometimes, because they don't always have the same body language of eye contact and giving that verbal feedback. In fact, you can't even read in their body a lot of times how they're reacting at all to something. So if someone's ever said, oh, you don't even care about this, maybe you're an introvert and you just don't show it, that you do care and that you are thinking about it, but you just don't express it. So let's go through some examples. Who would interview better? The expressive person who's willing to go out and say exactly what they do, they are going to interview a lot better. So with introverts, if you're the one doing the interviewing, you need to draw them out a lot more. And with extroverts, what you see is what you get. And with introverts, there's so much more. So you have to remember that if you're an introvert interviewing as well. And even let's think about all different kinds of communication. And how an extrovert or an introvert might be in, say, a team meeting. An extrovert will be the one talking. The introverts might be quieter. You see, extroverts don't mind answering right away and approaching. The introverts tend to wait to be asked. They have a wealth of information. They just need to be drawn out. So this is really important for managers and teachers to know that there's all kinds of methods, and here's one example. You can lead before the question and say, think about this for a minute before you answer, and then pose your question. If you take that time frame, you will get more introverts answering. You can also call on them, of course, but I would give you one hesitation there, and that is that extroverts like to answer right away. Introverts like a heads up, and they want that think time. So if you call on them first, you're probably not going to get a full answer, and they're going to be caught off guard as well. Let's talk about that in terms of rewards. Extroverts love rewards. Reward them anytime, all the time. Give them the encouragement. They want that. But the introvert, if you reward them too much or compliment them too much, what happens is they start thinking, what are they up to? What do they want from me? It's just our type. It's really how we think and how we process and where we get our energy is a lot of how we will react to these kinds of things. So let's go through a couple more examples. So we did the team meeting. Let's see, if you're an extrovert and you like multiple, relationships, you probably have, sometimes when we do the activity where we ask, what do you want to do for your next decade birthday? The extroverts tend to answer in large quantities of people. Oh, I want to take 100 of my closest friends. And the setup is that it's paid for by someone else and you can go anywhere and do anything. So the extroverts tend to have a long birthday. They tell all their friends. They invite all their friends. They might have professional singers. And I mean, they do up a huge event. Introverts tend to be with just family, maybe just their spouse, and they don't want to tell everybody about it. Introverts, they can have their birthday and you don't even know it happened. Extroverts, you generally know that they just had their birthday or they're about to. Here's another example. Let's say you go on an airplane and you sit next to an extrovert. By the end of that flight, you might know so many things about that person. You might even know their whole life story and the most important highlights of their life. You can know an introvert for years and not know a lot of personal information about them. So I hope that helps you in trying to figure out who you are, maybe who some of the other people in your life, how they react, and you can sometimes read this in people, but sometimes you can't. Let me give you an example where you might misread someone. A lot of top executives, say CEOs, might get misread as extroverts because they lead a company meeting, and they look like they have all this energy and they're exuding it and they're leading, but what do they do afterwards? is the key to their energy. Do they then go need some downtime and do a solitary activity or time in their office quiet, or what are they doing right after work? An extrovert will tend to get right back on the phone, be fine to be with lots of people, and continue that. Extroverts are the last to leave a party. Introverts are typically the first to leave because they're losing energy with people. So we can misread people. It's not about being social. Introverts can be very social, but they're losing energy as they're doing it, so they're not staying as long. The more social they are, the more they got to get out of there to then go do something. You'll find introverts love gardening. They love when they're doing a sport, they would prefer to maybe do it alone or with one other person. They tend to want to be in small groups or with one-on-one, and that's where they really blossom the most. And if you have a friend as an introvert, they will be a true long-term friend, especially two introverts together. So extroverts and introverts, we've learned a lot about them. Let's take a look at how else we might be able to see them in, say, a school ground. If you have approximately 75% of the population are extroverts, so in a class of 20 kids, you've got about 15 extroverts and 4 to 5 introverts, right? Here's where you'll find them on the playground. The extroverts tend to clump together in large groups, maybe one big, huge group, maybe a couple big groups, maybe they have boys and girls have split up, but they're in a big group and they're out there playing or talking about what they're gonna do or setting up the rules. The introverts, you'll find them on the outskirts. They're sitting by the coat rack or they're sitting on the outskirts somewhere on a bench and they're looking in and they're wondering, why don't I want to be in there? Yes, I do. I do want to be over there, but no, I don't. I really don't. And they sit there and they think through this. And it's very tough for an introvert growing up because they aren't like everybody else necessarily, but they are like the other introverts in this area of preference. And if they, like I said earlier, become friends, they are really strong, truly good friends. And so extroverts might be friends with the entire class and invite the entire class to their birthday party. Whereas, like my second born, when I ask him, so who do you want to have to your birthday? Oh, just Josh. Just one kid. That's it. And I didn't push him because I knew. I knew he was an introvert. And I had already figured that out. But when you look at that versus my firstborn who wants 15, 20 kids, and I had to put the rule of, oh, only your age, that's how many. You know, you're turning 7, you can have 7 kids. You're turning 8, you can have 8 kids. It's getting kind of bigger though. He's 11 this year, so it's getting a little too big. So we go to the beach or something where we can handle lots of kids. So when you look at the difference in extroversion and introversion, you can see it in 1 and 2 year olds. It is an inborn thing where we really are who we are and we're just acting it out as we go. So how can you communicate better with an extrovert? Be social, notice and respond to their expressiveness. Take turns, give them feedback. They want to know where they stand and they want to know now. Be a good sounding board. Let them elaborate and tell all. Expect detail and expansion and allow them to self-disclose. Expect them to talk about people and things. And don't withdraw from them. Open up, stay close, smile. They need that feedback. To communicate better with an introvert, slow down, get serious. Give them the time and space to think things through alone. Be patient. Give them the time to answer that they need. Focus on ideas. Allow for their privacy. Again, they don't usually like surprises or the spotlight, so be careful about that. Keep them prepared for what is about to happen. So by giving them some lead time and a heads up. We act different when we are in stress as well. Extroverts will speed up. Introverts will tend to slow down. Okay, let's move to the second area of preference, and that is sensors and intuitives. This is about how we process information. How do I know what I know? What sort of information do I pay attention to most? Sensors tend to want to see it, touch it, taste it, feel it. They want to live in the here and now. They consider themselves practical, down to earth, adaptable. They really like to do things sequentially and have a lot of detail. So they want the 1, 2, 3, 4. What's expected of me? A, B, C, D, E. Now let's talk about how the intuitives process. How do we know what we know? And what sort of information do we pay attention to? Intuitives pay attention to random, general directions. They look at the big picture. They look at the future more than here and today. So they rely on imagination, speculation. A lot of times they receive information through what we'd call a sixth sense. And they can't even explain, especially to a sensor, why they know what they know, but they know it. Because they do learn randomly. And so therefore, they gather information from a variety of sources and try to put it all together to explain it to the sensor of why they think the way they do. But they value inspiration and great ideas. You could talk about intuitives sort of like being their head in the clouds, whereas sensors, you'd say they have their feet on the ground. So where the intuitive is thinking, what if, the sensor is thinking, what is? Okay, so you might be getting a little bit of idea about who you are and who some of the others are. Let's talk about a few examples. If you've got a sensor and an intuitive, and they're going to go buy a car, a sensor wants to see it, touch it, taste it, feel it, right? So they are definitely going to test drive it. In audiences, I'll ask, how many of you test drove a car? And 100% of the sensors tend to test drive cars. They just do. It's something where they have to get in and feel it and know it. Okay, so it's a great example. Intuitives, a lot of times they'll just see it on the road and go, wow, I'd look good in that. Or I just like that car. Or I know that's practical for us. And they don't necessarily. You'll get a much lower percentage, less than 50% of intuitives that actually test drove the car before they bought it. And there are blind spots to all of it, of course. And the blind spots for the sensors are they might not be looking at the big picture or staying in the game of where an organization's headed. Intuitive, their blind spot is they might not think through all the details for their great idea. But we need both. Can you see that? Can you see in a team meeting what's happening or a family meeting? The sensors are talking about the details and the strategy of, okay, we got to, what's step one, what's step two? While the intuitives are thinking about, well, what if we try this and what about this and the possibility thinking. So the challenges really lie in our communication when someone's the opposite. But you can kind of see how actually it would be best to have both on any team, in any organization, in a family. It really is best to be thinking about not only the big picture of what we want to do, but the details of what's needed. Even if we're going on a vacation or a outing for the day, those practical down-to-earth people are going to make sure we plan for lunch and have our coats and have everything that we need. And then the big picture person comes up with the big idea. Ooh, what if we try this? And if that doesn't work, we've got this, this, and this along the way that might work. So we need both. They're both very important, but it's important to what you are and the other person you're communicating with. So let's say, for example, that you're an intuitive and your boss is a sensor. So the sensor boss, the way they're going to communicate mostly is they're going to give you a bunch of details and here's the steps of what you need to do. And if you're a sensor, that's great. But if you're an intuitive, you're confused. Because you see what there is to do, but you need the big picture to even be able to function and do the to-dos. And it's really hard if you don't have that big picture. You're stifled as an intuitive. And so therefore, those to-dos don't make sense. And you run around trying to figure out what the whole picture looks like until you can move forward in that. Now let's flip it around. Let's say the boss is intuitive and you're a sensor. The intuitive calls you in and says, oh, here's the end result I need in the project, and here's what I'm looking for, what I need from you. And the sensor walks away thinking, I have absolutely no idea what to do today. I can see the big picture, but what am I supposed to do towards that? They need that sequential one, two, three. They like, sensors like, continuity too. They like to do the same thing over and over. In fact, when you get to the extreme end of the sensors, you'll find that they eat the same thing every morning for breakfast over and over. And they love that. And they love that consistency. And the other end of intuitives, they can't even imagine it. They always eat a different thing. They like a lot of variety and change. So you can see in organizations and families when there's a big shift in changes, that some people are more adaptable than others, and now you know why and what's behind it. Okay, so that's the information processing. The first area was about how we get our energy. The second was information processing. Now, let's talk about how do you make decisions, because we do this in two different ways. We have thinkers and feelers, and thinkers tend to make decisions based on the head. Objective, detached, what's the law, firm and fair. It's impersonal. They put themselves outside the decision, even when they should be inside sometimes. They focus on right and wrong, criteria, reasons, standards. They will dig up lots of facts and data. The feeler is a little bit opposite. They rule with the head and the heart. Excuse me, the heart, not the head. They're subjective and involved. They involve themselves even when they shouldn't at times. Have you ever been told you're taking something personally? When you see it as personal, you might be more the feeler. Decision maker, focusing on people, feelings, things, harmony, caring and compassionate. So when the thinker's thinking about the law, the feeler is thinking about the extenuating circumstances. So using empathy and sympathy and intimacy, focusing on the good and bad, that is all more the feeler. Can you see how we need both? In families, in organizations, we need a good balance of both. Both are very great ways to make decisions. But when we have 100% of one and zero of the other, which is not exactly how it would work, but just to talk in extremes so that we understand what the blind spot is. Because whatever our strength is, that flip strength is our blind spot at times. So let's go over a couple of examples of that. In fact, a lot of times when I'm working with management groups, I'll pull up five people who think for sure they're thinkers and five people who know for sure they're feelers. And I'll ask them, what's it like to fire someone? And the thinkers go through it. Well, it's a logical process. You know, they had standards. There were goals for the job. They weren't meeting them. They pretty much fired themselves. And I'm not saying it's not hard for thinkers. And there have been plenty of thinkers who've even said, hey, it's not that I don't care. It's that I really, it's not about me. It's not what I did. It's what they did. The feeler throw themselves into it. Remember I said that? Well, here's how they do it. Oh gosh, you know, maybe I should have written them up more, or maybe I didn't train them well enough. You know what? I need to give them another month or two. So it takes feelers a lot longer to fire someone. And they think about the extenuating circumstances. Oh my gosh, it's Christmas time and they have four kids. This is not a good time to let them go. I'm going to wait two more months. Can you hear the difference? There are extenuating circumstances, even though there are laws. There's a personal commitment to it, even though it might not be yours. You might need to separate yourself. So in this, we can see our strengths. We can see some blind spots. So thinkers and feelers make decisions very differently, but we make a more balanced decision together if we can talk through both sides of it. What I want to mention right now is I have handouts that are free on the website that have cheat sheets for this, and they talk about not only the both sides on what their strengths are, but then how to communicate with them and in stress what they're like. Because you could actually pick up this paper and go, okay, I know I'm a thinker, I'm going into a meeting with a feeler, or I'm going to have a conversation with someone in my family or somewhere where you're volunteering with the opposite, and you can go look at their list and how can I communicate better with that person. So for example, with a thinker, you want to be more reasonable. Approach problems and decisions with logic and analysis. Explain your reasons, why, you know, look at the data, the facts, what's true, just, fair, objective, stress, cause and effect order, that kind of thing. So when you're communicating with a feeler, it's very different. Be sensitive and caring. Address feelings, yours, theirs, everyone affected. Stress harmony, caring. Emphasize the subjective and humanistic values. Figure out what they appreciate and what they're attracted to in the situation and draw conclusions from experience and feelings. Be compassionate, cooperative, and address hurt feelings, because with a feeler that will get in the way of decision making if you don't. Have some compassion and apology there can go a long, long way with a feeler. So in this third area of preference, again, it's the decision-making. How do I decide? What do I decide? What information is most valuable to me in drawing conclusions, and how do I process that information? So the fourth area of preference, this is very simple in figuring out what you are. There are judgers and there are perceivers. Judgers tend to like to live and operate in the world organized and detailed. They like to have a day planner. They want to have a plan. They want to create the plan. They like lists. They like to have things decided. And they will usually stick to those commitments. In fact, their blind spot is sometimes they get a little ruffled when the schedule goes awry. And now let's look at perceivers and their strength. They are adaptable, flexible, and they really think of themselves as keeping their options open and let's wait and see. Deadline? What deadline? So thinking about being spontaneous and hanging loose versus being structured and having a plan. Okay, both are needed in many situations. In fact, I always say, I think it's a sick joke in parenting that if you're a good planner and well-organized, you've got to become very spontaneous because who knows what's going to happen with children, and you could have a great plan and it all goes very quickly when something happens with the kids. And so the opposite is true as well. If you're really spontaneous, adaptable, flexible, but you have to, as a parent, then become more structured because you know that it's better to have a bedtime where you've got, you know, you're reading the books and brushing teeth and all of the things that need to happen in order and structure for a child's best growth. So we do need to do the opposite at times, but we have our own preferences. And how do we all get along with all these differences? You've got the extroverts being the most vocal. You've got the introverts who aren't saying as much, but they have lots of thoughts and feelings in there. You've got your sensors who are talking about the details and very focused on what are we doing today. You've got your intuitives who are looking at tomorrow and looking at 5 years from now and thinking, what if, and what are the possibilities of what we could do here? You've got your thinkers who are being very factual, detailed, and looking at the laws about whatever it is you're talking about. And you've got your feelers who are saying, how's this going to impact the people, the end users? How's this going to affect our family and externally other departments or other people, as well as just the immediate obvious people this will affect? And then you've got your judges who came to this meeting thinking you're making a decision, and you've got your perceivers who think you're just gathering information, you're making a decision later. How do we ever get anything done? It's amazing, isn't it, when you start to think about all the different ways that we communicate and all the different things that can happen in a meeting and in just two people trying to make decisions together. It is amazing. So really, when we look at how do we communicate better, let's summarize let me do one more example for those perceivers and judgers, if you weren't absolutely sure about that. If on a Tuesday you call a friend who is a judger and you say, hey, you want to go out Friday? A judger will answer with something very specific. They might say, yeah, I was thinking about, there's a great movie and I know it's showing at 7 o'clock at such and such location. And we could meet at 5 before that for dinner at such and such restaurant. And they will be there. And they tend to like to make a plan and have the plan. Let's say it's Tuesday and you've called your friend that's a perceiver. Hey, you want to go out Friday? A perceiver might say, oh yeah, give me a call on Friday. We'll figure it out. Now do you know what you are? And you know the opposite? So when we are communicating with someone who's an extrovert, be energetic and social. When you're communicating with an introvert, slow down and get serious. When you're communicating with a sensor, be specific and practical. When you're communicating with an intuitive, be imaginative and focus on the future. When you're communicating with a thinker, be reasonable, task-oriented. When you're communicating with a feeler, be sensitive and personal. When you're communicating with a judger, be punctual and plan ahead. When you're communicating with a perceiver, be spontaneous and flexible. This doesn't mean you change who you are. What it means is that you're flexing to communicate better with someone, to have better success and improved relationships so that you're understanding someone even better. They don't even need to know this information. It sure would be nice, and you could share it with them too, but even in situations where you cannot, you can flex to what their needs are, draw them out more, and have a better connection with them. So honor your strengths, share your talents, and appreciate others with equal and opposite abilities and preferences. In closing, communicating beyond your own style, we all have our preferred ways of operating that work best for us. Just remember that others don't all have those same strengths, and we can solve a lot of challenges we have with others when we really understand that we actually benefit from those differences, and that we will successfully not miss anything if we work together with them, even with our children. So from details to big picture, from task to overview to people impacted, to how we make decisions together, missing none of the angles, we then realize that going beyond our own style benefits everyone. And no one, like I said, needs to know this, because it can benefit you right away after listening to this, to help you in your family, your business, and your community. If you do want to dig further into this information by taking the Myers-Briggs Indicator to verify your type that you've already probably figured out, receive free handouts, or just look for more resources on great books about this, visit the website and look at the Myers-Briggs page, where you'll find a lot more on this topic. I wish you the best in type watching, shifting your communications, and seeing amazing results. Go out and be the best communicator you can, because somebody needs you to.
We hope from today's program you are now focused on your next step. For free handouts and more topics from Jennifer, please visit www.jenniferspeaks.com and call to refer or book Jennifer in your city.